I decided to hike the Appalachian Trail when I was beginning to love a girl named Sunshine. That was her trail name, which she'd been given when she hiked the AT 2 years in a row in 2004 and 5. The journeys had so changed her that when she returned to civilization, she continued to go by her trail name. Hearing her stories inspired me, and the year I turned 30, I was ready to attempt a through hike of my own. Sunshine wondered what this long separation would mean for us, but she'd followed this path before and supported me on the journey. On a foggy morning in early February, we drove down to Springer Mountain, Georgia together, and I began walking. The Appalachian Trail is a 2,186-mile footpath stretching between Georgia and Maine. It passes through 14 states and gains a total elevation equivalent to climbing Mount Everest 16 times. The average person takes 6 months to walk the entire length of the trail. Section hikers do this over a span of years, walking one bit at a time until they've completed it. To walk the entire trail in one long backpacking trip is known as a through hike. I began my through hike early in the season to avoid the rush of northbound hopefuls that would descend on Springer in March and April. Starting in winter would give me more space in the shelters and solitude on the trail, but it would also expose me to the extremes of winter weather. Sunshine hiked with me for the first day and night, and then she returned to her home and job in Asheville, North Carolina.
How are you feeling this morning?
Well, it's mixed. I'm excited for you, but I'm gonna be sad to say goodbye, even though right now it's just for a week.
Yeah.
But I think just the knowledge that it's gonna be a lot longer than that, even though it's just a week, it makes it hard.
The day Sunshine left, I tried not to think about the scope of what lay ahead. I focused on the trail in front of me and on the white blazes that marked the way. I met two other hikers who had set out early. Erin and her dog Chevy were from Manitoba, Canada, and Stephen was from Gulfport, Mississippi. Both Stephen and Erin were first-time backpackers struggling with the transition to trail life. Their packs were too heavy, their bodies not acclimated to the mountains. Like many thru-hiker hopefuls, they were learning to backpack as they went and coping through the process.
How are you feeling, Erin?
I feel like shit.
I've been planning to do this hike for 2 years now, but I don't think you can be prepared enough. My first couple nights sucked. My pack is way too heavy. And I think we only did 3 or 4 miles the first couple days, got caught in the rain. Everything got soaking wet. And I've ended up dumping a lot of my stuff into the garbage can, so don't bring things you don't need.
Can you give me a picture of how much dog food you were carrying?
I was carrying 40 pounds of dog food. So that wasn't gonna work.
And Stephen, how's the experience lived up to your expectations or your vision of how it would be?
Well, I came for a wilderness sojourn a la John Muir, and I got the Donner Party.
Describe for me the scene last night in the shelter.
Chevy sandwiched was in, around the dog.
Yeah, Chevy was in my sleeping bag.
So you're 30 miles into what could be a through hike, what you intend to be a through hike. Do you think you'll make it at this point?
I think I'll make it. It's like yesterday. Just do it. I'm thinking no matter how bad it gets, I'll just keep putting one foot in front of the other. And as long as I'm putting one foot in front of the other, no matter how slow that is, I'm making progress to Katahdin.
The dawn on Blood Mountain was beautiful. Ice had covered the trees overnight, and a sea of clouds rolled through the valley below us. Stephen and Erin were stopping that day at an outfitter in Neal's Gap to see how much weight they could cut from their packs. The first lesson the Appalachian Trail teaches is what you can live without. Almost all backpackers go through a process called the shakedown, in which they leave behind anything not essential to life on the trail. The idea of shedding the cares and trifles of the modern world has always been central to this path. It was one of the things most inspiring to the man who first envisioned the AT. Benton Mackay came of age at the turn of the 20th century, as the Industrial Revolution reached its peak in America. His adventures as a young man in New Hampshire's White Mountains shaped his love of wilderness. Following this passion, Mackay earned the first degree in forestry awarded by Harvard University. He went on to a career in regional planning, and in 1921, he published an article that first described the possibilities of a footpath stretching the length of Appalachia.
What captivated Mackay? That's a profound question, because the man was, you know, world-class genius, really. He felt that the Appalachians should be a way to contain civilization. He was profoundly worried, and he was prophetic about what came later, which was mass urbanization, then suburbanization, along with the automobile.
The United States was industrializing very rapidly. It started after the Civil War, and it moved very quickly. Product companies were cutting down trees. We were building industries. Especially the eastern part of the country was being pretty much overwhelmed by industrial development. At the time that he came up with the idea, he was working for the federal government, and he felt that unless we preserve these wild lands, they will simply disappear. And one of his ideas was that we ought to have a trail that people can walk through the wild lands, but they had to be wilderness. He did not want a trail that did not go through wilderness.
Mackay's vision inspired a movement of people who set about making the trail a reality. Over time, the AT project saw changes in leadership and values. Some saw the trail primarily as an opportunity for recreation and exercise in the woods. Others would come to see it as a challenge, a way to test themselves. But throughout the trail's long development, the promise of escaping the cares and frantic pace of the modern world remains central to its appeal. It continues to speak strongly to this day.